Hello, welcome to Rappler Talk. I'm Marites Vitug, and today we will be joined by UP Professor Maria Ella Atienza, and we will be discussing something that is really basic in our political life, the 1987 Philippine Constitution. It's interesting that the UP team was the project to assess the 1987 Constitution was led by Professor Atienza in partnership with an NGO based in Sweden called International Idea. So welcome to Rappler Talk, Professor Atienza.
Thank you, Ms. Vitug.
It's actually very timely that you assess the Constitution because there are so many proposals mm-hmm. out there to amend it. So maybe basic information first. Why the review of the 1987 Constitution now? And maybe just some of your basic or major findings.
Okay. Yes. Good morning. Can I call you Marita?
Yes, please.
Yes, call me Ella. Yes. Okay. And thank you for Rappler for featuring our project. So we actually did this project in line with what started in 2016 when President Duterte started proposing changing the constitution and shifting to a federal system. And since 2016, actually this project started out in the Department of Political Science where I am, of course, a professor. And since 2016, we have been writing position papers for the two houses of Congress when they had hearings. And we had engagements with International Idea, and in 2017 we had a collaborative project focusing on a series of public fora focusing on the 30th year of the Philippine Constitution. We assessed that, and then by the end of 2017, together with the UP Center for Integrative and Development Studies of the UP system, we hosted the international forum, the second Melbourne Forum on Constitutional Design in the Asia Pacific. And from there, they asked us if it's possible for us to do an assessment which is similar to what International Idea partnered with some academics in South Africa. And that was the first pilot site of their constitutional performance assessment tool. So what we did for the Philippine case is to adopt the International Idea constitutional performance assessment tool. It looked at what they say internal criteria, looking at how the major objectives of the constitution have been achieved, and external criteria, the general aspects of reviewing any constitution. And they use that term thin compliance. Yes. If, for instance, the institutions, the laws, and the schedules mentioned in the constitution are met, and thick compliance, which is more qualitative, it's a general assessment of the deeper or more substantive performance of certain aspects of the constitution. So what we did is to adapt that performance tool in the case of the Philippines, because we were feeling that there were so many discussions already about should we shift to a federal setup, what should be the appropriate form, when we have not really looked into how our constitution was performing. Because, well, right now the constitution is in its 33rd year. And according to constitutional design scholars, the median age of constitutions worldwide is only 27 years.
So you mean,
so it's time to, of course, constitutions endure because of undergoing certain amendments on certain constitutions. But I think what's important is to check why our constitution is surviving. It has survived coup attempts. It has it has been used for impeachment and removal or threats of removal of certain officials. So what we decided to do is to check what are the positive aspects in terms of how the constitution is performing, and if there are areas that need improvement, what would be the appropriate step? So can I discuss some of the findings already?
Just one question before we go to the major findings. Constitutions can also be ignored.
Yes, that's true.
Or, I mean, rejected by the executive. But anyway, We'll talk about that later. Yeah. Please go ahead with the major findings.
Yes, so this is a collegial work with seven faculty members of the Department of Political Science. In terms of major findings, we found that, for instance, elections are not yet truly free, open, and competitive. And the main problems would be because we have weak political parties. We have problems with election laws, particularly our party list law, which is not achieving its main goal of having alternative political parties
to
represent.
You propose deleting
and
provision.
Actually trying some aspect of the proportional representation system. We also noted that until now we see the dominance of political dynasties, personality politics, and patron-client relations. So even if the Constitution is saying that the election should be inclusive, we still see a lack of procedures that would allow illiterates and persons with disabilities from actually exercising their right to vote and for more people to actually run and possibly win for public office. In terms of the relationship among the major branches of government, despite provisions that are supposed to strengthen the legislature and the judiciary vis-a-vis the executive branch based on, of course, the lessons of the Marcos years, and which actually was one of the basic features of the 1987 Constitution to sort of bring back the balance or the checks and balances, we still see the dominance of the chief executive. And the reason for this, for instance, in the weak performance of the legislature is that, again, it's related to weak political parties. We have the pork barrel politics. The legislative bureaucracy is very weak compared to the politicians. And there is lack of transparency in terms of the many procedures, for instance, the Commission on Appointments, and then, of course, the bicameral conference committee. In the case of the Supreme Court, we found out that definitely the Supreme Court has increased powers under the 1987 Constitution, and it has actually used the power of judicial review on a number of cases. But performing that particular constitutional mandate has also made it the target of the two other branches of government. So we see a lot of threats to the independence of the judiciary. And even if the JBC, the Judicial and Bar Council, was created to sort of insulate the appointment system from politicians, it's still a very politicized process. At the local government level, we see a lot of exemplary local government units trying to perform the functions given to them by the Constitution and the 1991 Local Government Code. But not everyone, not all LGUs are able to do this because of the imbalance in terms of not just the resources available, but also the expertise and the availability of qualified people, not only to be at the top level of local governments, but also the local bureaucracy. We lack qualified people at the local bureaucracy. Extensive rights have been enshrined in the Constitution, but they are not evenly implemented. Filipino citizens still lack equality in terms of participation and representation in many of our institutions and processes, including, of course, access to courts. And then we have a number of accountability institutions. We have the Commission on Audit. We have, of course, the COMELEC. And then, of course, we have the Sandigan Bayan and the Office of the Ombudsman. But it's still challenged by threats to its independence. Mm-hmm. And we still see corruption as a problem despite many laws and reforms that have been instituted. In the security sector, civilian oversight is still difficult to implement, and while the economy has been improving through the years at the macro level, poverty remains a challenge, and there is still no equitable economic development. So the idea is one of the goals of the Constitution is actually to make economic development equitable, we still see disparity not only among sectors but also across regions.
Actually, what you're proposing is really a vast blueprint.
Yes.
I think some of the measures, as your study shows, go beyond, I mean, are outside the Constitution.
Yes.
You also propose legislation.
Yeah, because we think that while there are certain amendments that may be required in the Constitution, there are actually provisions that have not yet been implemented. There are laws that are still needed to actually actualize what was written in the Constitution. And of course, some things cannot be written or simply put in the Constitution. There also, of course, as a political scientist, we know that institutional reforms can only go so far as long as, of course, the political culture and the people, the stakeholders, are actually implementing and following the principles enshrined in the Constitution.
It's also timely, I think, that you did the review because, as you said, 1987 Constitution was a response to the Marcos dictatorship.
Yes, yeah.
Now, we are seeing a very strong and, in fact, authoritarian president who, tends to dismiss or reject or just unilaterally does things. For example, I just wanted to bring this up because it's so timely, is the unilateral termination of the visiting forces agreement and also the withdrawal from the International Criminal Court. Can you talk about this issue and what your findings are on this regard?
Yeah, although we did not have a very specific section focusing on the specific powers of the Senate in terms of abrogation of veto of let's say agreements and treaties, because we found out that the legislature, because of the problems I mentioned earlier, has some difficulty in. Particularly in the present administration, but of course we also saw difficulties as they relate with the executive branch in previous administrations. We also think that there's a need to clarify the specific powers of the two houses of Congress vis-a-vis the president, because in certain areas the Constitution is not clear. So for instance, the Constitution states that of course the Senate has a role in approving treaties, but it does not say anything, although of course the Senate has, and of course the House of Representatives have an oversight function when it comes to how the executive branch is performing its duty. So in this sense, we need to clarify some of these things, and it also makes the third branch of government, the Supreme Court, also potentially very powerful in actually putting clarity into the relationship of the two branches of government, in the same way that last year the Supreme Court has actually, in a way, put a different interpretation about where the shares of local governments will come from. So in that sense, we see here how potentially useful and powerful the Supreme Court is, but at the same time, of course, as I have mentioned earlier, it's also very sensitive and it's also potentially subject to a lot of pressures. But at the same time, we see here the need for the two other branches of government, the legislature and the judiciary, to actually exercise their right to check and balance the executive branch.
I was wondering, did your team meet with policymakers, legislators, and did you present your findings?
Yes.
Oh, you did?
Yeah,
Did they accept them?
As I told you earlier, since 2016, we have been presenting bits and pieces. In the beginning, the Senate seems to be more supportive, because we were saying before shifting to federalism, we need to focus on more incremental changes. But now, I think we presented the draft findings last year to the House Committee on Constitutional Amendments. And then earlier this month, we also participated in the House Committee hearing. And some of them are actually open to, we were surprised that some of them are supportive of the anti-turncoatism provision. Some of them would really really like the political parties to be stronger and to be more independent. And some are actually open to, if not banning, but limiting political dynasties. Yeah, and at the same time, they were also talking about how to make elections and political parties more inclusive.
So what is the best way to amend the constitution? What is the process that your team recommends? That's my first question. And then maybe the follow-up will be about the, you said earlier that instead of shifting to a federal system of government, let's look at incremental.
Yes.
So anyway, what's the best process?
Yeah. Actually, of course, at the beginning, the allies of the president were proposing the two houses transforming themselves into a constituent assembly because they were saying it's less costly, inexpensive, and of course, you have lawmakers who have been conducting meetings about changes in the constitution or amendments in the constitution. But at the same time, also, of course, based on literature, the constituent assembly path may also be questioned because on the one hand, you're also taking the legislators away from their day-to-day work, which is actually legislation and oversight. At the same time, also the legitimacy issue and the possibility of them being influenced by, the, of course, the executive branch and whoever may be at least the majority. So that may be some of the problems. The Constitutional Convention, of course, we have said that the advantage of the Constitutional Convention is that it encourages participation of more sectors. You can have election or appointment of people who are not politicians. But of course, it depends on the Republic Act that will call for the creation of the Constitutional Convention. And they can concentrate on the work of actually reviewing the Constitution. But of course, it's more time-consuming and definitely the question is, do we still have time for a constitutional convention? Yeah. But the problem now with the current composition of the two houses is that the Senate, of course, would like the... There's a very vague aspect of how they will form themselves into a constituent assembly and how they will approve amendments or revisions to the constitution, because this was admitted by the framers of the constitution themselves, the 1987 constitution. They were not able to clarify whether the two houses will be voting jointly or separately. And probably because at that time they were saying that there was also a debate whether the Congress will be unicameral or bicameral. So they failed to actually address that. Now, the Senate seems to be reluctant to constitute themselves into a constituent assembly. They want probably the Supreme Court to settle that particular issue, and at the same time, they are not also saying that a constituent assembly is a priority or the amendments are a priority.
In fact, the question now is, we only have two and a half more years.
Yeah.
Is there still time, I mean, to amend the constitution? Would you propose that it take place at this time?
There are actually some good proposals coming from the interagency task force that focus on incremental changes, and some of them are some of our proposals as well. But the problem is, perhaps this year is the only time available, but they have a lot of issues.
Correct.
And when we attended the House of the House Committee on Constitutional Amendments, they were also conscious of the time. They were also, in a way, they were thinking, is it possible for a plebiscite to support a constituent assembly? But of course, the problem is, do we have time to really inform the people about what is at stake? Because based on surveys, people do not seem to have a clear understanding of the stakes involved and the details involved, whether we shift to a federal system or we have all these amendments. And by next year, many of our legislators will be focused on the 2022 election. So actually, time is running out. But definitely, there are certain issues that need to be resolved.
Did your team look at you have a section on the economy.
Yes.
Did your team look at foreign ownership of public utilities? Because it's now,
yes, it's now
happening.
And that's the focus actually of many of the legislators, or at least the interagency task force pushing for constitutional amendments, as well as a number of legislators in the House are actually in agreement in terms of opening up certain sectors of the economy. Unfortunately, because we did not have an economist in our team, we have political scientists and lawyers, we did not look into ownership, but particularly what would be the appropriate percentage as opposed to the current 60-40, or opening up certain areas to foreign ownership. But what we mentioned in our report is that whatever changes in the constitution in order to achieve economic development and equity in terms of access to the economy and the fruits of the economy, they should not be done sacrificing some of the important provisions in the constitution, like social justice and human rights provisions, particularly the rights of our laborers, the rights of women, indigenous people, and other sectors.
I think a new factor that's being talked about now in opening up, let's say, ownership of public utilities is the China factor.
Yes.
So at the before, it wasn't really much of a consideration.
Yes. Although, of course, we can understand that in 1986, the Constitutional Commission, the CONCOM, was also conscious of actually our history of being colonized. Of course, the fear at that time was, of course, for those who are more nationalist in terms of orientation, the US and Western factor. But now, of course, we have a new foreign player.
And you also, I think, did you look at term limits? Or is it part of a package of reforms you're proposing?
We did not change the current provisions on term limits. Although we understand that even if we have term limits, if we will not have electoral and party system reforms, basically we will still have the same people or the same families participating in elections.
So beyond term limits, there are more fundamental reforms which you discussed.
Yeah.
And also, you talked about thin compliance.
Yes.
But I think you've covered this. But is there a big factor which makes our compliance with democracy thin? It says there's thin compliance with the goals of the Constitution, like economic development, democracy, and human rights.
Yeah, we said that there is thin compliance because some of the necessary laws have already been introduced. Elections are held almost regularly except for the barangay elections. We have the laws related to creation of the local government code. We have laws related to, for instance, protecting particular sectors. We have the Magna Carta for Women. Yes. We have laws protecting, for instance, our indigenous peoples. But the problem is in terms of the actual actual implementation, and at the same time also, it's also because of the weakness of our institutions. Mm-hmm. We have weak bureaucracies. At the same time, it's difficult to really talk about achieving many of the substantial aspects or goals of the Constitution if, number one, many stakeholders, including our own citizens, are not really aware and familiar with the Constitution. They're not really taught properly in schools. And at the same time, also, our institutions are still weak and in the process of trying to strengthen the institution and not the officials and not the personalities.
Yes. Maybe one final question. I mean, you've looked really extensively at the Constitution and even beyond it. There has been discussions on revolutionary government, which was suggested by the president himself a few years ago. Does this mean that the constitution will be dismissed, will be totally rejected, or there will be... this is just a scenario.
Yeah, of course.
People talk about it, that they say, oh, baka mag-rev go tayo.
Yeah.
What are your thoughts on this?
Of course, it was not discussed because we were talking about the constitution and nothing in the constitution talks about a revolutionary government. The idea of a revolutionary government is a bit curious because when we look at, of course, the survey ratings of the president, when we look at the composition of the two houses of Congress, it seems like he's in control. So what is actually preventing him from actually exercising his influence for the two houses of Congress to actually pass laws that he needed? And of course, but the problem is he seemed to have already given up on the federalism proposal. In his last sona, he did not even mention it. And then when he was interviewed afterwards, he said it may no longer happen during his term, but he wanted some changes in the constitution. And in a way, that's the reason why the interagency task force is focusing more on, I don't like the term, but they call it surgical amendments to the constitution. But when we look at some of their recommendations, and we have been actually interacting with them since 2016, and we were happy that they were talking about the reforming the political parties, making them accessible and accountable, preventing turncoatism, and then also making sure that there are limits to political dynasties. But of course, the problem is whether this will be, supported by the two houses of Congress, and at the same time also, of course, the time factor. Do we still have time?
And there's been a pending bill, right, to reform political parties and to achieve what you just said.
Yeah, it has long been filed in several Congresses, and that's the reason why some of those championing this is that if we cannot pass it as a regular Republic Act, maybe we should enshrine it in the Constitution. Because it's more, as we are seeing, it's more difficult to change the Constitution. But of course, the question is, do we still have time, and will there be enough support? And of course, you need not just the House of Representatives, you also need the Senate to also agree to open up the Constitution.
I think your proposals are timeless. What I mean is they can be taken up in future governments.
Yeah, our goal actually is to produce not a definitive analysis. We actually want this to be open for debate, but at least have a baseline study about where the Constitution is right now and what could we do. Given this assessment, some scholars may not agree with some of our recommendations, but at least we can talk about where we are now, and perhaps we can debate what would be the most appropriate way. But as we are saying, of course, we can go so far as amending the constitution, having laws, but of course, if we are not implementing the constitution and the laws to the letter, and we are not achieving the goals, then they will be useless.
Yeah, on that very useful point, Ella, our professor Atienza, we end this interview, and thank you. And maybe to our viewers, as Professor Atienza said, there seems to be a low awareness of the Constitution. So I think it will be interesting for all of us to look at the issues, especially because there seems to be a threat to our basic democratic government under this administration. So thank you for viewing, and thank you for listening. And we will continue this conversation on the Philippine Constitution.
Thank you.